Hey, good morning. I'm so glad you're with us today. Hey, this is the time in our service where we normally talk about what we are preparing to give to the Lord and how the Lord has taken care of us. And there are lots of ways we can give. And while right now in this moment, what we're going to do is give financially to support the ministries of this church, I want to talk about another way that you can also give. And you can support not only the folks that attend this church, but the folks in our community. And while I'm talking about giving the gift of health, this year, we are told by the experts who look at disease that the flu is going to be 6 times worse this year than it was last year. We know that because of what happened in Australia already. This is how we gauge and know, and they plan for the strain of the flu. And they said the very best time to get your flu shot is in the month of October. That they know what's they now have watched a little bit. They know what to put in this shot, and it's the best thing to do. Here's the thing. If we want to take care of one another, one of the things we need to do is to make sure that we're healthy. And when you're sick, we're going to ask that you take the option of watching online at home. And if you can't watch online, this is what we're going to do for you. We will give you a copy of the service for free. So all you have to do is say, I need a copy, I was homesick, and we will give that to you. We are going to give each other the gift of health. But to bump it up even more, we have made sure that in front and in back on a stand is this little thing called a hand sanitizer. You can stick your hand under there and you can get rid of all your germs before you come in and touch each other. That's a good thing to do. Yet better than that, Monday, October the 28th, if you do not have a flu shot already, I want you to come and get one. Starting at 4 o'clock, Monday the 28th, right here in our prayer room. That's the day of our food giveaway. But we will be offering through Good Samaritan Hospital flu shots. If you have insurance, just bring your insurance card. If you're on Medicare, just bring your Medicare card. Or if you don't have Medicare, you don't have insurance, I want you to see my husband because he will pay $35 for you to get your flu shot. He's such a generous man. Such a generous man. Thursday, when I said that, we got in the car and he goes, Debbie, do you know how many people told me they need a flu shot? Yes! So here's the deal. Here's the deal. We really do think this is important. We want to make sure that we've got some people in our congregation who need us to be healthy because their immune system is suppressed or because they're getting ready to go through surgery. Joanna, she can't get the flu. If you're not feeling well, stay away from Joanna, okay? When baby Lily comes, she's going to come in a few weeks so that we can dedicate her. They're going to come once the service starts, leave before the service is over. Same thing. Don't touch those folks that we know their immune system really isn't what it's going to be, or we don't want them to catch the flu. So give the gift of health, and I know no one really wants to get a flu shot. I don't want to do it. We tried to get somebody to come and do it on the stage, give me a shot on the stage, and they told me it wasn't appropriate. So apparently I don't know proper protocol. Go figure. So I'll get my flu shot on October the 28th right here in the prayer room, and I'm going to ask that you would join me, and we are going to give each other the gift of health. If you've got one of those white buckets, let's start passing it around.
Fight for another day.
Stuff. Amen. So this morning, if you're joining us online, we want to give you a big Thursday Church Sunday edition neighborly welcome, because we are continuing our series titled Love Your Neighbor as Yourself. And we're wanting to make sure that we know exactly what is required of us as we are choosing obedience to God's perfect plan. And see, we want to know what it is. We want to embrace what it is that we're agreeing to. Week one, we talked about the reality of what it looks like to love your neighbor who's living physically right next door to you. Week two, we expanded our understanding of what Jesus was referring to with the word neighbor to include a total stranger. And each week, we've left here with action points, things that we need to be doing. Week one, we began praying for our neighbors. Week two, the action point was to answer three questions about the eight people living around you Because what we found out is, for the most part, 99% of the population, those people are strangers to you. I know that sounds odd, but as we're talking about strangers, for the most part, only 1% of the population could answer those three questions about their neighbors. And so we're talking about loving the people physically next door, loving a total stranger. And today we're going to push the envelope a little further, and we're going to talk about love in regard to our neighbor in a whole different way of embracing this word neighbor. And we are going to be challenged by God's word and what it means and how he instructed us to love our neighbor. See, we are incapable of living up to God's word if we aren't willing to embrace God's word. It's not just that we say yes to Jesus. It's that we say yes and then we follow in obedience with our lives the expectation of what it means to live out these relationships that are right in front of us. Relationships that might be challenging. Relationships, and we aren't just talking about those easy relationships, the ones that are ready-made, like your family. And if you're sitting there going, well, you don't know my family because they're not easy. Well, that may very well be true, but that is a ready-made relationship. Your neighbors are a ready-made relationship, but what about total strangers? And then, what if we take it a step further? What about our enemies? You know, we got to wrap our mind around the fact that Jesus very well may be saying to us, our neighbors are our enemies. That one's a tough one to pull together. Jesus said in Mark 12:30, of all the commandments, of everything that has been written, of all the laws, he said, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. He said, this is the greatest commandment of all, that we love in this fashion. Say that with me. You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And then Jesus goes on to say in verse 31, and you must. Not you should, not it would be good, not I think it's a good plan, but he said, you must. He has made this very, very, very clear. This is something, as a follower of Jesus Christ, it's not just something we say that we're going to try to do, we must do. This one law that is more important than anything else, this loving God and loving others, we've got to know exactly what it is we are agreeing to. Because if we don't know exactly what we are agreeing to, do you know what will happen? We won't find ourselves walking in obedience. We won't find ourselves doing the very things that we are to be doing. In Micah 6:8, we're told that we are to do justice, that we are to love kindness, and we are to walk humbly with our God. And see, we can't do those things. We can't offer justice. We can't offer kindness. We can't walk humbly if we haven't backed this up to the very core and the very foundation of what does this one most important commandment mean. See, a lot of times we jump into Christianity and we jump way over here at the action steps. We want to jump over here at what are we supposed to do? How are we supposed to live it out before we have the foundation of what it really means? We need to know what we're agreeing to. We need to know what it means to be found obedient. We need to know, what does it truly mean when we say, I am a Christian? When we say, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. I am called to be his reflection to this world. We need to know what that means. And when it comes to the greatest commandment of all of loving our neighbor, we've got to grasp what that word neighbor truly means. And unfortunately, we have gotten really comfortable in our world today with agreeing to things that we do not understand. And that is just normal. We just agree because we need to move on. Perfect example is with this teeny little multinational corporation called Amazon. I'm being sarcastic. It's not a teeny little corporation. As a matter of fact, it's one of the, I can't remember if it's top three or top four e-commerce businesses in the world globally. Amazon is huge. It is a huge corporation. But before you can enter into a relationship with them, they require that you agree to their terms and conditions. And if you do not agree to their terms and conditions, you don't get to be in their in a relationship with them. You don't get to purchase and have something delivered from Amazon. It just doesn't work that way. So you've got to agree. And since we really don't want to take the time to read the terms and condition contract, what we do is we just blindly click the button that says, I agree, hope for the best, and move right on. And I know that we're doing this because of what it says on Amazon's webpage. On Amazon's webpage, it says that if you choose to read the terms and condition contract, the agreement in which you are signing, you need to be prepared to know that it will take you approximately, I love that they use the word approximately, like a few minutes here or a few minutes there. No, we are talking hours. They said it will take you approximately 9 hours of your life to read the terms and condition contract. You want to know what you're agreeing to? Folks, if we read it, we wouldn't understand it. And if we did understand it, we wouldn't agree to it. There's stuff in there that none of us would agree to. But yet, blindly, we click, I agree, so we can move on. See, when it comes to our faith, folks, we cannot have this kind of attitude that we are going to blindly click, yep, I believe in Jesus. Yep, I want to be a follower of his, and then not understand or know what it is required of us. There are requirements for being a reflection of Jesus Christ. See, it doesn't just happen. You have to choose obedience. You have to choose surrender. You have to choose to take God's word and chew on it every single day so that we are embracing the truth of what does it mean to take this greatest commandment of all and live it out for the world to see. And this word love, we're supposed to be loving. I think we know what it feels like to receive love. We know what it feels like to offer love, but are we really willing to allow our mind to go into this place of understanding who our neighbor is? The love that we would willingly accept for ourselves, to ourselves, for ourselves, is the same kind of love that we need to be offering to our neighbor. John 10:10 said that Jesus' words were, my purpose. See, his reason for giving you these terms and conditions of being a Christian, he says, my purpose is so that they can have a rich and a satisfying and an abundant life. See, it's not like with Jeff Bezos with Amazon. His reason for having you agree to the terms is for his benefit. Jesus is saying, I want you to agree to this stuff. I want you to embrace this stuff. I want you to know this stuff. I'm going to live 3 years here in ministry, doing ministry on this earth so that you can follow my example in every area of your life because I want you to get it. Not for my benefit, for your benefit. Very different than what Amazon is trying to get you to agree to and what Christ is calling you to agree to. And if you've ever picked up your Bible and it felt like what this Amazon terms and condition contract looks like, Jesus said, I don't want you to be confused. I want to just make this simple. I want you to grab what it looks like to be a part of my kingdom. And I'm not trying to complicate things with my word. I want my words to be simple. And so he breaks it down. And then he said, you know what? Here are the terms. Here are the conditions. And yet I'm going to put a plan in place for when you break the contract. I'm gonna go ahead and put a plan in place so that when sin comes your way, when you don't live up to the greatest commandment of loving your neighbor, when you choose to reject your neighbor, when you choose to offer hatred to your neighbor, when you choose harm for your neighbor, when you have revenge against your neighbor, I'm gonna put in place a plan so that you can be forgiven, so that those sins can be erased, they can be removed and even forgotten. And that plan is the cross. And so Jesus wanted to make sure that we understood that he didn't just die for us. We understand that he is God in the flesh. 3 days later, he rose from that grave. And his testimony was there for all to see. And then he ascended into heaven for them to see so that we could understand there was a plan. The plan is perfect. The plan goes beyond the realm of anything that we could ever, ever, ever embrace. And this forgiveness is complete. It is this opportunity to know that the plan is good, but when we don't live up to the plan, there is a plan for that. And that we are forgiven. And that God's plan is perfect. And so this issue of the greatest commandment of loving our neighbor means that it's a very important part of who we are as Christ followers. So as we look at this group of people worldwide who call themselves Christ followers. We are part of his family, part of his group. It seems like there should be a common denominator that would allow us to be recognized in this world. And yet, that common denominator seems to be very, very, very difficult to discern. Why? Because God's people aren't living up to the terms and conditions of the agreement, loving your neighbor. We will love when it's easy, but we are challenged to love when it is difficult. And he is saying, this is it, folks. You want the abundant life. You want the rich life. You want the satisfying life. We need to have this common denominator of walking by faith and loving even the people who are difficult to love. You know, when you look at a nation, it's easy to identify that this is a nation. There are three common elements that identify that this is what a nation is. There's a common people. They look alike. They use the same language. When we go to Guatemala, it is very apparent that I am not from Guatemala, that I am not of their nation. My skin color is the wrong color. My eye color is the wrong color. My hair color, I stand out like a sore thumb, and I'm tall there. You know, I'm like a giant there. I'm tall. I mean, there's this common people that identifies that they belong to a certain nation. There is this element of a common land that they understand that over to the ocean over here, or to the hills over here, or the mountains over here, this is the area that we call, this is the land that we identify as our nation, where this common people lives in this common land. And the common people in a common land have a common law. And they say, these are our laws, and we follow these laws. These are the laws of the land for these people. And so it makes it easy to identify, these are the folks that live in accordance to this nation. But when it comes to Christians, it's very different. When it comes to Christians, see, Christians have every language. Christians come from every race, nationality, gender. Christians don't, you can't just look at Christians and say, well, they live in this particular land. And so this common denominator, Christ said, I want to make it easy that people can see that you are part of this body called Christians. And it's that you're going to love in a fashion that is different than the rest of the world. You are going to love the people who physically are next door to you. You are going to love the stranger on the street. But you are going to know that you know that you know that you're a Christ follower when you are willing to love your enemy. And so we have this story that just speaks into that kind of love. Open a Bible and we're going to turn to Luke chapter 10 and we're talking about this element of of loving even when you are the rejected one. So here we are. We're going to be in chapter 10 looking at verses 25 through 37, page 863. One of the reasons I love reading the book of Luke is because he is so stinking bold. He doesn't care if people are going to like not like what he has to say. He is the only one who has the guts to share this story in print. They all heard the story. They all knew the story. They all experienced Jesus sharing these words. But Luke's the one that's got the guts to put it down on paper. You know, with Matthew, he records the element of love your neighbor. But Luke goes ahead and finishes the story for us. And he tells us what Jesus offered as an illustration when he taught about the Samaritan man. A Samaritan man would have been rejected. A Samaritan man would have been mocked. A Samaritan man would have been hated. So here we are as we are thinking through what does it mean to love our neighbor. Luke 10, starting with verse 25. And a lawyer stood up and he put him, talking about Jesus, and put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What's written in the law? How does it read to you?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, and love your neighbors as yourself." And he said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But wishing to justify himself, he said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied to him, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among robbers, and they stripped him, and they beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. And by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed to the other side of the road. Likewise, a Levite would have also been a a religious leader of the day. And likewise, a Levite also came to the place and saw him, and he also passed to the other side. But a Samaritan," remember, this is the rejected person, this is the mocked person, this is the person that no one would have wanted to have contact with. "The Samaritan was on a journey, and he came upon him. And when he saw him, he felt compassion. He came to him, he bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and water upon them. And he put him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. On the next day, he took out 2 denarii and he gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I return, I will repay you.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" And he said, "The one who showed mercy to him." And Jesus said, "Now go and do likewise." Go and do likewise. Even if you are mocked, even if you are hated, even if you are rejected by the very person you are caring for, chances are this man who had been beaten was not a Samaritan. Samaritans just don't travel the road from Jericho, from Jerusalem to Jericho. They just don't do it. It would not have been wise for a Samaritan. I'm not even sure why this Samaritan was on that road, because Samaria is over here. So if you're looking at a map, and here's Jerusalem, here's Jericho, they're not very far apart, but in between is this terrain that is really rugged, that's rough. And there's a pathway through. It's kind of like a shortcut. But every now and then, there are robbers who hide out on that shortcut because of the terrain allows them to be able to hide behind some bush or some shrub or some hill. And so while you take a chance at the shortcut, instead of going up and around the terrain and coming down to Jericho this way, the shortcut A lot of folks would take the shortcut if they felt, especially if they were traveling during the day. They felt like it was safer during the day. We don't know why this Samaritan was on that road, because Samaria is up here, but he was. And what we do know about a Samaritan is that they were not loved. They were rejected. If we were telling this story today, to make this story impressive upon your mind, that Jesus is saying, look at this guy. He's being mocked, made fun of, rejected, and he is going out and offering love to his neighbor. Surely you can do the same. It would be like telling this story modern day and saying there was a Hindu, a Muslim, a Buddhist, and he stopped. Even though he's rejected, even though he is hated, and he offered help to someone different than him. How willing are you to cross cultural, ethnic, all of these boundaries, religious, social boundaries? How willing are you to cross those boundaries to offer love? Even if you're mocked, even if you're rejected. See, this offering love thing isn't that you just offer the love if the love is returned to you. Loving your neighbor, loving in the way that Jesus loved, we are to go and do likewise. And even if we are the one being mocked, even if we are the one being rejected, even if we are to offer the love, even if it is difficult, we are to offer the love. Even if it puts us in a situation that brings us into this space of controversy, this space of danger. The priest, he wasn't willing to stop, probably because he assumed the guy was dead. And if he had stopped, then he would have not been ceremonially clean when he got back home. Chances were he's just been at the temple. That's why he would travel to Jerusalem. The priest took turns about every 2 weeks. A different priest took care of the temple. It wasn't like now where there is a pastor over the church. They all shared the job of taking care of the temple. So chances are he had just finished his two-week stint. So we know that he's been purified. We know that he's ceremonially clean. If he would stop and go over near the corpse of what he thought was this dead man, then when he got back home, he wouldn't be able to do the religious work that would need to be done, especially if he's been gone for 2 weeks. And so the best thing for him to do was just to pass to the other side. The Levite may have been afraid that if he stopped, he too would have been robbed. He probably thought it was a dead man also, and this could have been a trick. So the best thing to do is to just keep moving. But the Samaritan, Christ tells us, had compassion. And folks, when you live a life of compassion, I want you to know, I want you to see that God's hand of protection is upon you. I want you to trust that. And even when you feel as if you will be mocked for stopping to offer help to someone, you do it anyway. And that's what it means to love your neighbor. The depth of loving your neighbor that goes past just someone who's physically near you, just a total stranger on the street. How do you respond when someone is ethnically different than you are, socially different than you are, religiously different than you are? Because I'm telling you, when you love your neighbor in that fashion, you are stretched beyond measure. When he said, go and do likewise, he didn't put a parameter that says, you only love those who will love you back. You only love those who are easy to love. You only love those who look like you, sound like you, speak like you, who fit in this common denominator of your nation. If you're only loving like that, you are missing the boat. And you are cheating yourself out of the fullness of living out obedience. When we live out the fullness of those that obedience, we're told that what Christ wants to offer us is a rich, satisfying, and abundant life. Do not cheat yourself out of a rich, satisfying, abundant life. Ask yourself this week, how you doing? How you doing in this relationship thing? Folks, we cannot let our religion come before our relationship with the God of this universe. We have changed a lot of things culturally that Christ didn't call us to change. And if you're going to love your neighbor, it also means loving those who are culturally, socially, ethnically different than you, even if they would call you their enemy. This week, I want you taking your seat reminder home, and I want you asking yourself, do I love even in spite of discrimination? Am I willing to step past that and offer the kind of love that Christ is calling me to? Amen?